Welcome everyone to the Spectral Geometry in the Cloud seminar. Today we have the pleasure of having Yves Collin de Verdière from Institut Fourier, who will speak about the spectrum of the Poincaré operator in an ellipsoid. And the stage is yours. Thank you.
It's very nice to speak at this seminar. I will discuss first what is a Poincaré operator in general, and then what is a special if the domain is an ellipsoid. Let us start. So it's about fluid mechanics. So it's a fluid which is inside a domain D, which is smooth and bounded in R3. And we consider a fluid inside the domain, which is incompressible and is submitted to a rotation, a fixed rotation, one half of omega, because there will be two omega in, so better to make this normalization. Neglecting the viscosity and assuming that the velocity field is small, we have a linearization of the Navier-Stokes equation, which is called the Poincaré equation, which I wrote here. So V is the velocity field. So if you have, you want to have the motion of a single particle, you have to integrate V, but it's better to put the equation as an equation on the velocity. So the time derivative of the velocity plus the wedge product of the rotation and the velocity is equal to minus the gradient of the pressure and two more properties. The divergence of V vanishes because the fluid is incompressible and V is tangent to the boundary. So the fluid remains inside the domain. The corresponding waves, if you look at this kind of wave equation, they are called inertial waves. They are due to the rotation, maybe to the Coriolis force. We denote small omega, the size, the norm of the vector big omega. This kind of equation, so the gradient of oppression is necessary, I will discuss that later, because you need to keep this condition of zero divergence. The equation were introduced by Poincaré a long time ago, and the name was introduced, the name Poincaré equations was introduced by Élie Cartan a bit later. And at that time, people were not speaking about operators, which is a more recent concept, but we will speak about spectral theory and operators, of course. I will show you the copy of the page of the Poincaré paper, where you can see the equation. Here it's UVW is the velocity, and omega is the rotation. And here you have the gradient of the pressure, and you have the divergence equals zero. And from that, he deduced a scalar equation for the pressure. But I will not do that, but that's something which is more or less equivalent to the Poincaré equation. And here is the introduction of the paper by Élie Cartan, which is, maybe I will read it in French. It is les difficultés qu'on a éprouvées à la lecture du mémoire de Poincaré tiennent plus, à mon avis, aux notations employées par l'auteur qu'à l'exposition elle-même. Une même lettre ρ servant à désigner tantôt une variable, tantôt la valeur numérique que prend cette variable pour l'ellipsoïde considéré. Blablabla. Bla. Et donc, il want to give a new exposition of the Poincaré paper, which is already, in my opinion, it's easier to read, but already quite difficult because people at that time, they know a lot of things we have now forgotten about special functions. And they speak of many special functions, which I don't know to what is this. And at that time, it was probably teach in very early in the courses. But in any case, Poincaré, Cartan paper is quite interesting to read, even if it's in French. But okay. So about we start a spectral theory. So we look at periodic motion for the speed. So if you have something like that, it means that the particle will move in an oscillatory way along the trajectory of the velocity field. And we get a spectral problem, which I rewrote it. So it's exactly the same equation, but I put I lambda as a time derivative. So it's exactly the same equation. And d u equals zero, and u is tangent to the boundary. The values of lambda for which there exists a non-trivial solution are the eigenvalue of the Zocon Poincaré operator P. And I will give a very simple formula for that operator. For that, I denote by V0 the space of the smooth divergent free vector fields tangent to the boundary. And in fact, we can complete this space and as an Hilbert subspace of all L2 vector fields, which is the orthogonal of the space of gradients of smooth function. That's why you have grad P here, okay? So you have a decomposition of the space of all velocity fields is the orthogonal sum of the gradients and the vectors, the vector field, which are divergence free and tangent to the boundary. From that, you can build a projector, an orthogonal projection, which is called the Leray projector, which is a projection of the Hilbert space, L2 of all vector fields, onto that space of divergence free tangent to the boundary fields. And this operator is called the Leray projector. And now we can define, we project everything on V0, and we define the Poincaré operator, which is you project your vector field P, you put the wedge product with the rotation, and you reproject to give you a well-defined operator. And the lambda, the value of lambda for which you have a periodic motion, are exactly the eigenvalues of P. So we are now in a familiar context. We have a nice operator, expected to be nice, and we look at the spectral theory of P. Moreover, this operator is bounded because pi is of norm one, and the wedge product with omega is also bounded. And the operator norm is smaller than the norm of omega. In fact, one can prove that the spectrum is symmetric, and it's a part of minus omega omega. In fact, the spectrum is exactly that interval. But as you know, if you have a spectrum which is like that, which is an interval, there are several possibilities. You can have some absolutely continuous spectrum at some part of the interval. You can have some pure point spectrum. You can have some singular spectrum, and so on. So the goal is to know what kind of spectrum do you have for the Poincaré operator. Now, if we go a bit more in the technology, P is a pseudo-differential operator of degree zero. Why is that? Because, in fact, the Leray projector is already pseudo-differential operator. And the symbol, which is a matrix symbol, because your operator acts on vector fields, is the orthogonal projection on the hyperplane, which is the kernel of the momentum, okay? Which is the equation div equals zero. Of course, there are some technical issues because we are on a manifold with boundaries, but I will not discuss that in the lecture. You can read our papers and see how we manage this difficulty. In fact, there is a theory of pseudo-differential operators on manifold with boundary, which has been developed a long time ago by Louis Boutin-Monvel, and we use this context. The pseudo-differential operators are Boutin-Monvel's operators, but we will forget about that and look as it was a closed manifold without boundary. So, if we look at the symbol, it's a matrix symbol, and as you may know, what is important is that if you have a symbol, a matrix symbol, it's like to have a sum of scalar operators whose principal symbols are the eigenvalues of that matrix. So you can compute the eigenvalue. They are given like that, plus or minus small omega, times the cosine of omega, the rotation, and xi, the momentum. So it's independent of x. And there is also the eigenvalue zero, which correspond at least to the vector field, which are gradients, because pi, Lorentz projection, kills the gradients. Okay, so you have also zero. But in fact, what we did with Laure Saint-Raymond is to look at the generic situations for pseudo-differential operators of degree zero. And in a few words, I will not speak about that. In a few words, there can be some attractors for the ray dynamics, which is the dynamics governed by the Hamiltonians, which are the eigenvalue here. And if you have such attractors, you have a spectrum which is absolutely continuous near that value. But it is a generic situation. And what we will see is that in the case of ellipsoids, we are not at all in that generic situation. That's the first message, and I will give you the statements. So the first statement is like that. It was proved by a physicist named Backus and by some other people too. And it was not published, apparently because it was rejected by the journal, or I don't know exactly. And it was revived by Backus and Reuter much later. And I heard Reuter is an astrophysicist in Toulouse. And I heard him speaking on that, but the proof in this paper is very difficult to read. So I will give you another proof, much simpler proof. So the theorem is as follows. You have an ellipsoid, though assume that the domain is an ellipsoid, a standard ellipsoid, okay, of this equation, a1x1 squared plus a2x2 squared plus a3x3 squared less or equal to 1, this a1, a2, a3 strictly positive. Then the spectrum of P is pure point. It means that you have an eigenbasis, an orthonormal eigenbasis of eigenfield of eigenfunctions, which are with polynomial coefficients. So all eigenfields, all vector fields which are eigenfunctions, have coefficients which are polynomial, or at least there is a basis, because maybe there are infinite multiplicity. In this case, you can build something, but at least there is some basis some orthonormal basis of eigenvectors, which are with polynomial coefficients. I will give you later a proof of that, which is something not so expected because the ellipsoid is completely arbitrary, the rotation is arbitrary, though it's not a symmetric situation, it's not a sphere with a rotation, it's an ellipsoid, so it can be very flat and not. It's so not.
I have a question.
In my opinion, it's quite surprising, but we'll see later.
I have a question, Yves.
Yeah.
Yeah. Is this compatible with the fact that you said the spectrum is the full interval?
Yeah, because it's a pure point dense, like the rational numbers.
Okay. Okay. Thank you.
It's pure point dense. Well, that's a nice example. It's not what people do usually in this seminar where. Usually, people have elliptic operators and things like that with a discrete spectrum. It's a different story, but in my opinion, there are many things we can do with that. So for later use, I will denote by Vn the space of eigenfunctions of degree less or equal to n, and Wn is the orthogonal of Vn minus intersect with Vn. And in fact, the space Wn are invariant by P as they are finite dimensional. So consist of eigenvalue because you have a self-adjoint operator which is on a finite dimensional space. So the goal will be to show that the space Wn are invariant by the Poincaré operator. And we can compute the dimension, which is n plus 2. But it will not be very important. And now there is another result, which is as follows. So you have this pure point spectrum. And now if you fix the degree, you have a finite number of eigenvalues, which I denote mu j n. So n is the degree and g is the labeling of the eigen values. And you will look at the repartition, the asymptotic repartition of these eigenvalues. Okay. So you define some probability measure, which is one divided by the dimension times sum of Dirac masses at this point. So that's a probability measure, which is supported in the interval minus omega, omega. And in a paper with Jeremy Vidal, which is an astrophysicist in Grenoble, we were able to prove the following result. There exists a limit, a weak limit of this family of probability, which is given by an explicit formula. So is given, so the integral of minus infinity to s of this limit measure is 1/4 pi times the area of the two spheres cut with the set of momenta for which omega cos omega square root of a is a diagonal matrix, square root of i are the parameter of the ellipsoid, smaller than s. And to our big surprise, Jeremy Vidal was able to compute explicitly the eigenvalue for small degrees up to n equal 10. And we saw that it worked very well. Okay, it means that the numerical computation are okay, and also my calculation are okay, which was a big surprise for me because usually I make many errors in my calculation. But nevertheless, this formula works, and so here you can see the density. P infinity for an ellipsoid which is rather flat. It's an ellipsoid of revolution, but it's flat in this direction. or in the other direction, it's very elongated. And the rotation has an angle theta with the vertical. Okay, you see that there are different profiles. So the rotation is assumed to be normalized between the small omega is equal to one. And you see the density is like that. It's something and the numerics fits exactly with this picture. Okay. So I will start by discussing the Backus theorem. And I discuss it for the ball because, in fact, once you know it for the ball, it's the same for ellipsoid. You make an affine transform from the ellipsoid to the ball, and you change something, but the vector field, which are divergence free, are the same. And so it's easier to do it for the ball, but for ellipsoid, it's the same. And in fact, it's about orthogonal polynomials, which are the game. So here it's an independent story, okay? It's a scalar now. What is orthogonal polynomial? You take the unit ball in R3 or Rn, it works also in Rn, with the Lebesgue measure, and you denote by P sub n the space of polynomial functions of degree less or equal to n, and by Qn the orthogonal of Pn minus 1 inside Pn. Okay, and Qn is the species of Qn, they are the sum of Qn, it's dense by Stone-Weierstrass theorem. And that's the orthogonal polynomial. It's not given by a basis, but by a vector species. So there is a vector species Qn. And in fact, it turns out that's the main input in our work, that the eigenspaces, they are the orthogonal polynomial species, they are exactly eigenspaces of some differential operator, some partial differential operator, which I wrote here for you, which is minus Laplace operator plus other terms, which are dx, cxj, dj. Okay, it's a symmetric operator. Okay, then the species Qn are eigenspaces of L with eigenvalues n plus 3, and the multiplicity is n plus 1, n plus 2 over 2. It seems quite strange because it's very similar to spherical harmonics, and I will explain that a bit later. We call L the Legendre operator, that was the notation, because in dimension 1, it's exactly the Legendre differential equation for orthogonal polynomials on the interval. And this result, which is here, is in fact in some paper by Apple and Campe de Ferrier, a very old paper, but the proof is quite difficult to follow, so I will give you a very simple proof of this fact. In fact, the proof is difficult to follow because if you start from the orthogonal polynomial, it's difficult, but if you start from L and you try to get the eigenspaces, it's much easier. And because it's symmetric, I will discuss the problem with boundary condition. It will be a self-adjoint operator. Then the eigenspaces are automatically orthogonal. Okay, so it's a very nice result. How is the proof? It's like that. The operator L acts on Pn in a triangular way because this part, that it's going from degree n to degree n minus 2. This part preserves the degree, but it's very easy to see that it acts on homogeneous polynomials with this eigenvalue. So you get a triangular matrix, okay? So you know what is exactly the set of eigenvalue of L acting on Pn. That's exactly the nn plus 3. With that multiplicity. And now you have to check that the eigenspaces are orthogonal. And for that, you have to check that L is symmetric on the space C2 of B bar, if you want. In fact, there is no boundary condition for this kind of operator. Well, in fact, it's related to the fact I forgot to mention that this operator is elliptic inside B, but it's not elliptic at the boundary, because the symbol vanishes at some point, which are the conormal bundle of the boundary. And because of that property, there is no Dirichlet or Neumann boundary. There is no boundary condition. So you check that. In fact, if you look at the Green-Riemann formula, there is a cancellation between the part coming from the Laplace operator and the part coming from the second part of the operator. So now you know what are the eigenspaces. They are homogeneous polynomial plus lower order terms, and they are orthogonal. So they are exactly the orthogonal polynomials. So it's very four line proof. It's very, very easy. The most difficult part is to check carefully that the operator is symmetric without boundary condition. But it works. Okay. And there is something very interesting, which I will use later, which is a similarity with spherical harmonics. In fact, this is not so surprising. We consider the three sphere in R4, so R3X is where the ball here, and you add a new dimension, and you look at the projection from S3 into R3, from S3 to B. And you can lift the operator from the ball to S3. It acts, if you want, on even functions on the sphere. And then the principal symbol of this operator L tilde is exactly the principal symbol of the Laplacian on the sphere. In other words, the Legendre operator is as the same principal symbol as the Laplace operator on sphere of dimension 3. In particular, the B characteristics of L, that means the trajectories of the Hamiltonian vector fields of the principal symbol, they are projection of grid circles on S3, so they are ellipses which are tangent to the boundary of the ball at two diametrally opposed, so that like that. That's a picture, very simple picture. Here you have R3, you have R, you have the sphere, you have a grid circle like that, and when you project onto R3, you get an ellipse which is like that, tangent to. And you see, it's like the fact that the operator L has no boundary condition. Here you have no reflection. You just follow the trajectory. There is no need to have a condition for the reflection. That's the classical counterpart of the fact that the operator is self-adjoint without boundary condition. And now I'll give you a simple proof of the theorem of Backus. I consider in general an operator which is a generalization of the Poincaré operator is pi m pi, or pi is a Leray projection and m is a constant matrix, any matrix, so for example, omega wedge or any constant matrix. And I denote by L3 the sum of three copies of the Legendre operator. Then Backus theorem follows from the fact that Q commutes with L3, of course, because then Q preserves the eigenspaces of L3. And in fact, M, because it's a constant matrix, it commutes already to L3, it's not a problem. So the main fact is that the Leray projector commutes with L3. In fact, it's enough to recall the decomposition of vector field into gradients and divergence-free vector fields. And it suffices to prove that the space of gradient of Smooth function is invariant by this operator. This is clear because L3 is delta, and delta of a gradient is still a gradient of delta, if you want. And L is a dilation And deletion of a vector field, which is a gradient, is also a gradient of a deleted function. Okay, so in fact, it's very simple to check that the Le projection commutes with the Legendre operator. That's a very nice fact. And in fact, it can be used with more complicated situation. With Jeremy Vidal, we are looking now at inertial gravitational waves. It's the same trick. And I will say a bit more later. In fact, it's the same for in any dimension. But in dimension two, as I will discuss if I have time, it's even more interesting because in dimension two, you have then two operators commuting in dimension two, so it's integrable. I will discuss that later if I have time. Okay. So the theorem of Backus is just something very, very conceptual. It's not a complicated calculation. If you look at the paper by Backus and Reuter, it's very complicated. And in my opinion, this proof is, at least I understand this proof. Okay. And now I want to discuss the other theorem, which is this one. Okay. And in fact, it's very close to what we did a long time ago with Alan Weinstein. It was started by Alan Weinstein. In fact, it's about eigenvalue clusters for Schrödinger operators on spheres. So with delta plus V, delta is a standard Laplacian on spheres, and V is a smooth function. And the eigenvalues are just some bounded deformation of the eigenvalues of sphere, k plus d minus 1, plus some bounded family, which is k is the degree of the spherical harmonic, and g is a labeling of the eigenvalue. And all, because v is bounded, all mujica are bounded. And we studied the asymptotic distribution of the mujica as I did in the statement before. So I look at a probability distribution built from Dirac Messis at that point.
Sorry, there's a question in the chat by Grigory Berkolaiko. He's asking what was the role of the matrix M in the proof of Backus theorem?
No role. In fact, because M is always, because it's a constant coefficient, it's always commuting with every differential operator. Because L3 is a diagonal. So you make linear combination, it's still an eigenvector. It's like a multiplication by a scalar. It's a matrix scalar, but it's not. So the main point is about the Lorentz. Does it answer to the question, Grégory? No? He disappeared. Okay.
I don't know. I will tell you if he replies in the chat. He said, but you wanted to understand the spectrum of pi.
No, the spectrum of Q, of P. Q. Oui, for the Poincaré operator, I have to specialize. If Q is P, M is a wedge product with omega. But it's more general. Okay. It's true for any M. For the Poincaré operator, is a special case of this.
Yes, okay, thank you.
I forgot to mention that. Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. So what we did at that time, which was started by Alan, is to look at the asymptotic behavior of the probability measure which are built from the mujicas. And in fact, V is not commuting with delta, but by some averaging, we can reduce to an operator delta plus V8 with V8 commuting with delta. And now we can use standard machineries in order to get wild type formulae for the joint spectrum of the two operators, which gives the asymptotic behavior. And from this, we got the asymptotic of the eigenvalues clusters. But now our situation is very similar and even simpler because P, the Poincaré operator, and L, they are already commuting. So you have no, you don't need this step here. Okay. Okay. In a more technical way, it's about a trace, distributional trace. So here it's the wave propagator associated to L. So I add this fraction in order to have exact square. It's n plus 3. So it's n plus 3 half square. So it's exactly n plus 3 half. Okay. And it's the wave operator associated to the Legendre operator. And you take any function of the Poincaré operator. So it's from the functional calculus, okay? And if you are able to say something on this trace, you will get. So this z of t is exactly like that, okay? So I can rewrite sum of an a minus et. So it's a Fourier series, okay? And if you have a Fourier series, if in fact you have the following fact. The fact that the Hamiltonian flow of the symbol of L, of lambda is the symbol of L, is simply periodic, which is the orbits are ellipses, and from the propagation of singularities, we can prove using the symbolic calculus, of, the calculus of wavefront set, that the singular support of this distribution is exactly the set of integers. Okay, so this distribution is smooth outside the periodic, outside the integers. And from that, it follows that the asymptotic of the Fourier coefficient is determined by the singularity of z at t equals zero. But now at t equals zero, it's very easy because f of p is a pseudo-differential operator. And this guy is a Fourier integral operator, and it has been studied by Ormander in his paper on the spectral function of an elliptic operator, what is the singularity. Of course, here it's more complicated because we have boundary and the operator is not elliptic at the boundary, but still we can manage. Okay. So from that, we get a formula in terms of a phase space volume, which is like that. It's simply with a volume that the symbol of f of p here, or the sum of the two eigenvalues. Here is a domain where the symbol of L is smaller than one. Here is the total volume. And now we first integrate in xi, in x, I'm sorry, in x, and you get the formula I gave you before, which is somewhere, which is here. Okay. It's, in fact, it's a phase space volume, but you can compute it. It's not too difficult. Okay. So we compute it and we get the formula. So in order to summarize, you have this pure point spectrum. You have the eigen spaces, which are vector fields with polynomial coefficients. And you have a limit distribution for the spectrum as the degree is going to infinity. Okay. Now, if I have seen still some time, I guess. Yes. About dimension two. So it's a very similar story. In fact, I did something with Zhenhao Li, which is a PhD student in MIT. So in dimension two, the Leray projector has the same property. In particular, we can look at what is called internal waves. Internal wave is for a medium which is stratified by the density. So, for example, you have some salt water, which is more salt, okay? And you have an horizontal stratification, if you want, okay? And it's stable because it's less dense in the when you are high, and more dense in the ground, okay? And if you have this stratification, it can oscillate, and there is an important physical parameter, which is, describes the oscillation, which is called the Brunt-Vesela frequency, which is given by the gravity, the scalar product of the gravity with the gradient of the logarithm of the density. And we assume that this parameter is constant. So it's the same as assuming, as I was doing before, assuming that the rotation is constant, okay? And then the dispersion relation, which gives the eigenvalues of the symbol. So that's the same. You look at Navier-Stokes, and you have something similar. You have an operator, and you can apply exactly the same thing. So you have the Backus theorem still holds for this operator. And the eigenvalues are given by n squared plus or minus n squared xi1 divided by norm of xi. Okay. Xi1 is a horizontal direction, and g is a vertical. And in particular, you can say what is the direction of propagation if lambda is fixed. So it's a very simple, it's an Hamiltonian which is independent of x. And you see that you have two possible directions of propagation, which are given like that. Okay. So the internal wave says propagate in some oblique direction. There are two oblique directions with respect to the stratification. Okay. And the associated dynamic is called the Chess-Billard, referring to the motions of the bishops on the chess game. You have the black ones and the white ones. There are two directions. If the domain is an ellipse, this billiard, the chess billiard, is always integrable. It's not surprising because I said that the quantum problem is integrable. In fact, it's like that. So you have your domain, and you have two directions, the green and the red. Okay, you start from a point, you follow the green direction. When you arrive to the boundary, you follow the red direction, and you get a transformation of the boundary, which is called T. Okay, and in fact, in case of ellipses, the transformation T is conjugated to a rotation. It's quite easy to prove because you can make some affine transform. Then you will change the direction, but now you have a disk. And if you fix the direction in a disk, give you an axial symmetry. So your transformation is exactly the product of two axial symmetries, and it's a rotation. In the case of ellipses, you have to make back the fine transform. It's still conjugated to a rotation. So it's integrable. So it's an integrable billiard. And one can ask about the Birkhoff type problem. The Birkhoff problem is to know if for the usual billiards, the dynamics is integrable. For what kind of billiard it is integrable, and the conjecture is that it's only for ellipses. And here you can prove the same, but the dynamics is not the same. The acoustics are not confocal ellipses, but are homothetic ellipses. It's not at all the same. So here is a picture from our paper. It's an eigenfunction. That's a picture of the vector field, which is completely explicit for the circle. Okay. In fact, here the spectrum is very simple. So it's still a pure point dense in some interval, and it's given exactly by the set of lambda for which the rotation number is rational. So it's very similar to the rational number. So it's in a preprint in an archive with Zenaogi. I guess that's all. I've finished. So.
Thank you very much, Yves, for the talk. We have time for a question, of course. So please either ask them in the chat or unmute yourself and just ask. So I have a very naive question. In the beginning, you said that the spectrum is, I mean, it's an interval, but it could be, I mean, you showed it's pure point and not anything else. What's the physical interpretation of this in terms of the model? Does it mean something?
It means that each solution can be decomposed as usual in spectral theory as a linear combination of polynomial vector fields and so on. I don't know how to.
Okay, I was wondering if there's.
No, but the problem is that in astrophysics or in things like that, ellipsoids are very current, very usual. You know, all planets or stars are usually ellipses. Okay, so in fact, that's a great simplification of Navier-Stokes equation. But after, you have to make again the perturbation. But if you know that the starting situation is so simple, probably it's easier to make the perturbation and to look at turbulence or something else or what happens. But I know nothing about that. You should ask to physicists. I am not at all a physicist. But it's interesting to discuss with physicists. Reutter, for example, or Bacchus or Reutter, they were physicists. So it's, and my collaborator, Jeremy, is a physicist too. So it's sometimes difficult because, it's not the same background.
There is a question in the chat. The question is, do you have an example of domains where the spectrum is absolutely continuous?
No. But from what we did with Laure Saint-Raymond, we guess that it is a generic situation. In fact, there is a paper by Dyatlov, Zorsky, and maybe a third author, I don't know, where they prove that for in dimension two for internal waves for some domains. They prove that if you have some attractor, so it's more or less a generic situation. So they study very carefully this situation. What we did with Laure Saint-Raymond was for manifolds without boundary. We were able to describe the occurrence of absolutely continuous spectrum in presence of what we call attractors, which are attractors. Of course, it's Hamiltonian dynamics, so there is no attractors, but there are attractors at infinity. If you want, for pseudo-differential operators of degree zero, the characteristic manifold or the energy set is a cone. So you can go to infinity. And there is some dynamics at infinity, which is the projection of that dynamics. And you look at attractors of that dynamics. And in fact, what happens in this case, if you look at the evolution equation for that frequency, at the evolution equation for that frequency, you will converge to a state which is not in L2, but those waveform state is exactly a part of that cone, which is the cone generated by the attractor. It's another story that we did with Laure.
Thank you. Does anyone else want to ask a question or comment on something?
Hi.
Hi.
If you don't negligence the viscosity, what is the added term about the equation?
I'm sorry.
Is there an added term
about I'm sorry, I don't know.
If you don't.
Your question is about viscosity? Or?
Yes, about the viscosity.
We look at that. In case of internal waves, there is a paper also by Dyatlov Zorsky, where if you add a viscosity, you add epsilon Laplace operator. So for epsilon fixed, non-zero, you have an elliptic equation, and you can look at the spectrum of that elliptic equation. And in the situation of attractors, the spectrum, the eigenvalue of the viscous operator, they converge to what they call resonances. Okay, but in our case for the ellipsoids, it's not clear what happens. Maybe it's very similar, but I'm not sure. It's a good, because of course But no, there is a problem that probably the delta, the Laplace operator will not commute with the Leray projector. I'm not sure. If it commutes, then you can do the same. But I'm not sure if it's commute. I don't know. Maybe.
Yes, because I think with viscosity, we have some difficulties like existence and density of solution.
Of course, but then your operator is elliptic.
Okay.
It's no more a bounded operator. It's an elliptic operator. But I guess that it's no more self-adjoint, so you have no good spectral theory. You have complex numbers. But the zero viscosity limit, it was studied by Dyatlov-Zorsky for internal waves. And that's already something difficult. That's a difficult paper.
Okay.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
And thank you, Mouhamadou. There is also a question in the chat by Grigory Rosenblum. He's asking if there are domains with isolated eigenvalues.
No. In fact, the spectrum is always exactly that interval.
For any domain?
Nothing else. The bound is exactly the norm of omega. And it's dense because it's a set of values. You have the symbol. And it's exactly the set of values of the symbol. Mm-hmm. Because once you have a values of the symbol, you can build some approximate eigenfunctions, which are just a coherent state associated to, or plan wave, or what you want, associated to the. You remove the value and you can build some approximate eigenfunctions. So it's the spectrum is always minus omega, omega. But even in the situation we are looking with Laure Saint-Raymond, it can be some embedded eigenvalues in the continuous spectrum. That can happen. I guess there are some examples by some student of Zorsky or I don't remember, but it's possible to have some embedded eigenvalue. But it's not isolated. But what we did now with Jeremy Vidal is for we add the rotation and the stratification, that inertial gravitational wave, then you have some interval where you have pure point spectrum, which is dense, but outside the operator is elliptic and you have a discrete spectrum accumulating on interval of essential spectrum, like for Schrödinger operator inertry for hydrogen atoms. So you have some accumulation, but at the moment you are not able to say something precise on this accumulation. In fact, for this inertial gravitational wave, you have two symmetric intervals which are away of zero, where you have pure point spectrum. And inside, between the two intervals, it's possible to have a discrete spectrum. And also outside, because the bound for the norm is not exactly the upper bound of the essential spectrum. So you have the essential spectrum and maybe some accumulation of eigenvalue, but it's still not clear. I don't know, maybe you know, but I don't know.
Thank you very much. I think I don't see any other questions.
If you perturb a little bit the ellipsoid, does anything interesting happen?
I don't know. Of course, it's a very interesting question because usually for stars or things like that, they are not exactly ellipsoid, but they are very close. But my opinion is that once you perturb, it will come into the generic situation. I mean, you will have some absolutely continuous spectrum and things like that.
So there is no KM or anything like that now?
I don't think so. Maybe in 2D, because it's integrable.
Mm.
Maybe in 2D, but in 3D, no. In 3D, it's interesting because you have only two commuting operators, and except for very special situation, for example, if you have a sphere or if you have an ellipsoid of revolution and omega, is in the direction of the axis, then you have one more integral, then it's integrable. And in two dimension, maybe it's a good, very good question, because then it's a perturbation of an integrable system. So in this case, I don't know. It's a very good question. Maybe we'll be able to answer that question.
Thank you.
No, but it would be okay. Very, thank you for that question. It's a very, very interesting question. There is another example in 2D which is interesting, is the case of triangles. Because in case of triangles, there are always attractors. And the conjecture is that for triangles, the spectrum is really absolutely continuous for the complete integral, for the complete interval, for internal waves. And I don't know, but it's from the point of view of classical dynamics, it's like that. But of course, there is something more to do, but I don't know. Okay, okay. But it's a very good question, your question. I like it.
Thank you. Anyone else wants to ask something or say something? Let's thank Yves again. Thank you very much for this talk.
Okay. Thank you for people to hear me. It's good to have a shorter lecture so that people can ask questions at that time.